We welcome Olivier Guichard for the third season of his talk on another for presentations.
Okay, so thank you very much. I aim today to finish the proof of co-compactness in this two theorem I quoted yesterday, and then to say why Anosov group or Anosov representation are called Anosov. So I will go into the dynamical system and the flows that are associated with this situation. And I will try to prove an important property of Anosov property, subgroup or representation is their stability under deformation. So if you have an Anosov representation, then nearby representation are again Anosov, and it is an important stability property. So the setting is there. I was doing the proof in a particular case when gamma is isomorphic to the fundamental group of a compact negatively curved manifold. And I will keep this setting for the whole talk today. And this really is to simplify some step in the proof. So we don't really need this special assumption. But in this case, the fundamental, the universal covering of this compact manifold is isomorphic to open ball, and the boundary at infinity is a sphere of the dimension. So we had an Anosov subgroup gamma. So we have this its boundary map, and inside the space of isotropic plane, we define a subset that is closed and depend on the limit set of the group. And we claim that on the complement of this subset, the action is proper and co-compact. And we showed yesterday properness. And what is special about this subset is that it is really the disjoint union of this space G beta of eta that depends only on the line L. So G subscript L is also isotropic Q-plane that contain a given line L, and the fact that this map was transverse means that this closed set is really this disjoint union. In particular, it fibers over the boundary of the group, which is a sphere here. So the fibers are isomorphic to all isomorphic, and they are isomorphic to the space of isotropic planes that contain a given isotropic line. And we saw yesterday that in this situation, this is also equivalent that the W is contained in L orthogonal. So it means that W is in fact Q minus one, or comes from in fact for a Q minus one isotropic plane of this quotient L orthogonal divided by L. And you can calculate that the signature on this quotient is P minus 1, Q minus 1. Good. So I ended up yesterday by saying that the cohomology group I want to show it is R is in a five-term exact sequence. And so it's a bit of without saying it, calculating the equivalent cohomology of something, but we don't really care. And at the first two terms and the last two terms, I have this inclusion of this compact subset in this compact manifold. Okay? And these two things, fibers, over things that are that does not depend on the meaning of gamma into OPQ anymore. And the fibers are isomorphic to this in for the red arrow and to F for the blue arrow. So in particular, if the fiber are really connected. So if there are if p minus q minus 2, I believe, is bigger than m and m plus 1, the vertical fiber in this commutative diagram are isomorphic. So the vertical map, sorry, are isomorphisms. Good. And there is a small lemma that says that, in fact, the middle space has dimension control by the two extreme map in this situation. So this is the following. If you have a five-term short exact sequence, so you put name for the extreme arrow, so this is exact, then the dimension of C is the dimension of the co-kernel of F plus the dimension of the kernel. Okay, so it means that now this dimension does not depend on the special another representation which we started from, but it does just depend on this map and this map. Okay, so we are in calculating this first cohomology group, we get rid totally of the space cube. So if you do the same, but with F and G replaced by something you know as the action is concompact. So you replace it by the universal cover and its completion and the boundary at infinity of this universal cover. Okay, so what you calculate here is the cohomology with compact support of the U, which is a complement of the boundary in this. So you will calculate something that you know is R, and you will, in fact, in this situation, you don't have much to do, but you really show that the maps here are the same. So the conclusion now, so you get the same five terms exact sequence. Okay, and the conclusion now is that the dimension of what we are interested in is the dimension of the first or zeros cohomology group with compact support of this compact manifold. Okay? And this proves the argument, and this was the first part of the argument where we assume that P is big such that the maps here are isomorphism in cohomology or homology. Okay, so what do you do for P small? So you first choose P prime, that is bigger than M plus 1 plus Q plus 2. So I choose a P prime so that this argument will work. And I have OPQ that embeds in O P prime Q. the image of gamma in OPQ, OP prime Q, is still Anosov. So you can check that on the different definition of Anosov representation I gave, but the easiest way to see that is that mu I will not be a third in this embedding. So if you calculate mu1 and mu2 for an element gamma in OPQ, it is equal to the mu1 and mu2 in OP prime Q, so that if you have a control here, you have a control there. And so you have G prime in F prime that is FQ R P prime plus Q, which is and the action of gamma on U prime is co-compact. So it's compact. This one is compact, and G prime is the set of W, so that there exists L in the limit set contained in W. Yes, let me precise W in F prime. So my F prime contains F in particular, which is Q planes in RP plus Q. And the intersection of F with D prime is G. The intersection with F with this is a space of W in F, so that this happens. So this is exactly G. So the intersection of F with U prime, just taking the complement, is U. So this means that U inside U prime is a closed subset. Subset again. Okay. And since the action of gamma is proper on U and U prime, you deduce out of this that gamma mod U is a subset of gamma mod U prime that it is closed. Yeah. And now it's the end of the argument. You have a closed subset in a compact subset, so it is compact as well. Good. So this implies that gamma mod U is compact. Good. Good, that proved properness in theorem A, and I want to show now a properness in theorem B. So theorem B, maybe I will just put the setting. I have X bar was the space in the Grassmannian of Q plane in RP plus Q, such that the quadratic form in restriction to W is non-positive. Instead, I have a space, a subset that I called Y, but the same definition, the W as G, or a similar definition as G, it's a space of W, so that there exists a line in the limit set contained in W. And I want to show, I'm not sure I will give it a name. So I want that gamma. So we know that the action on the complement of Y in X bar is proper. So I can form this quotient, and I want to show that this is compact. Okay, and I want to do that by embedding in a way this situation in some FQ or something like this. But I had not really an embedding this time, but I will be able to have a proper map from one of these things to raise this question. So let's try to do this. And in fact, by doing this, I will give more detail on how you put OP Q in OP prime Q. And what will be P prime in this situation? It will be P plus Q. Okay. So on the space RP plus Q plus Q. Sorry of writing things like this, but I want to insist that I take P plus Q positive sign and Q negative sign. So this is R Q plus zero and a direct sum R P plus Q. Okay. And again, the notation try to specify the signature of the forming restriction. Okay, so this decomposition gives a number of things. So first, an embedding of OPQ in OP plus QQ. So element here acts on this vector space, and you made them act trivially on this Q space. It gives an embedding of the projective space also, but I will just care about the isotropic line in RP plus Q. So if you have an isotropic line in this space, you have an isotropic line in the bigger space. Yes. And I have also a projection that I want to call pi to R P plus Q. Okay. And I can restrict this projection to isotropic Q plane. Okay. So I call this pi star. It goes from the isotropic Q plane in R P plus Q plus Q to the Grassmannian of Q plane of RP plus Q, but in fact it goes exactly to X bar. Okay, and what does it do? I mean, you have a W here, and you just look at the image of W. Okay. An isotropic Q plane cannot intersect the kernel of pi, which is this positive definite set. So pi of W is always a Q plane, and so it's really something that is in the Grassmannian of Q plane. And why is it non-positive on X? This mean is non because of the fact that W is isotropic. You can write it as if you now write W as a map from a subspace here to this RP plus Q, this maps as to have its graph completely isotropic. The graph of this map will be completely isotropic. And this will force, I mean, since we are positive definite on the image, on the vertical direction, it has to be negative definite or negative on the base. So this is how you will show that, but a direct calculation in is in. Okay, so what we'll do this map. This map is OPQ equivariant. It is proper. And it is also onto. I mean, this is obvious. I mean, this is also obvious because, in fact, you have a map in between two compact sets, so it can not be something else that proper. And why it is onto? I mean, you can just check that X is in the image. Okay, you can find one element, one W, so that pi of W is a negative definite space. And once you have done that, but you have all the its orbit. So you have X inside the image, but since the map is proper and the image must be closed also, so you have also the closure of X, and which is exactly. And the last thing we know is that gamma in OP plus Q is another. So, yes, so why do I need to check is, I mean, put a small lemma, but it is a direct calculation. It's for every line in RP plus Q, every isotopic line, the inverse image by pi star of what you want to remove in FQ. No, it's Y. So I would like to remove in the compactification of the projective space is equal to what we are removing in RP plus Q plus Q. Okay, so so it says that L is included in W if and only if L is included in pi of W for every W in. And the direct direction is very easy because if you have the image pi in restriction to L is the identity, so you have pi of L included in pi of W, but pi of L equals pi. And for the opposite direction, you have again to think of W as the graph of a map from pi of W to RQ, and this graph being isotropic, we force that it is zero on the kernel of the quadratic form in restriction to pi of W. So the graph that defines W has to be zero on the kernel of this quadratic form, and L is contained in the kernel of this quadratic form. So you get the converged direction in this. Good. So what we have is that the inverse image of Y lambda gamma, so the disjoint union of YL for L belonging to the limit set, is equal to G lambda gamma. Okay, so what do I have now? I have pi star that restricts to F, which is a F of RP plus Q, but for which I remove the set G lambda gamma maps onto x bar minus y. Yeah, so this map is onto a proper, it is a gamma equivariant. And this is, I believe, all what I need. So since you know that you have a co-compact action, here you deduce out of the existence of this map that the action is again co-compact on this well, compactification or bordification on the symmetric space. So use the image of a compact domain, fundamental domain here will be something that is compact here and that is again a fundamental domain. Good. Yes, so now I would like to give why there is a dynamical system or on the flow hidden in the definition or in one equivalent definition of another subgroup, and to use this flow to show stability of another subgroup. So because this is the another nature of another subgroup. Okay, so let's try to do this. I again assume that gamma is the fundamental group of closed Riemannian manifold and negatively curved, and written by U, N, and U, and tilde, the unitary tangent bundle. And yes, and on this manifold, the geodesic flow will be denoted by phi t. So the universal tangent, the universal cover of N is a ball, and for every unit tangent vector here, its flow line goes to infinity in both direction, and I have 2 points here that I will like to denote phi plus infinity of V, which really belongs to the boundary at infinity of this manifold, which I would like also to identify with the boundary at infinity of the, and I also phi minus infinity of V. Oops. Good. Okay. So yes, I would like to work with the representation for this last part instead of subgroups. So I want to define what I mean by representation of a group gamma into OPQ being Anosov. Well, if the following happen, if its kernel is finite, and its image is an Anosov subgroup of OPQ. Each time I have a representation, I can build a number of bundles over n and over un, and I will mainly consider two bundles, the principal bundle associated with this representation, and the bundle with fiber F1. Okay, so if rho is a representation from gamma to OPQ, are we denoted by F rho? It's the bundle over the unit tangent bundle over N, and it is defined as being the quotient of U, the unit tangent bundle of N tilde cross F1. And what is the action? So, I want to give the action here. It's given by the action of gamma on a pair vector and a line. The gamma act as it can act on n tilde and its unit tangent bundle, its unit vector, and it acts by rho on the line. Okay, so and I think that the projection, I'm sorry, it's second P, the projection for the these bundles will always be denoted by P. Okay, so this is in a different font. Good. So when I have beta, the map beta can be used to define a section of this bundle. So the map beta sigma subscript beta of this bundle, and I can give the section at the universal at the level of a universal curve. So at the level of the curve U n tilde. This has to be a map from U n tilde to U n tilde cross F1. And it is this map has to be equivalent with respect to the action of the group, and it has to be a section of the first projection. So if I have a vector V, I have no choice. For the first coordinate, it has to be V, because when I project back, I have to find this coordinate. And I have to produce a line here. And I know how to produce a line when I have a point at infinity. And when I have a vector V, I know how to produce a point at infinity just going at the end of the. So the formula is beta of phi plus infinity of V. There is more because I'm looking at bundle and flat bundle over this space equipped with a flow. The flow lifts to a flow on the bundle. So there is a flow. There is the lift of phi t to F rho, and given at the level of the of U and theta, it's given by the formula phi t applied to pair V L. I cannot change L. There is no way to define reasonably a formula, but it just acts on second coordinate as a Josic flow and as L. Good. So both those formula are equivalent with respect to the action of the group, so they descend really to a section and a flow on. Okay. So what is the important property that I would like to prove? I put this as a proposition, but the flow phi t, so in restriction to what? To the image of the section sigma that comes from beta is expanding in the direction of the fibers. What do I mean by this? Is I mean this flow is against infinity, so it acts also on the tunnel spaces, and when you take a base point in this subset and a tangent vector to this base point of in the vertical direction, so in the fiber. And you look at its image under negative time of the flow, and this goes to zero. Okay. So yes. Yeah, so I work it exists for every W in the tangent vertical tangent space of F rho. This decoration in vertical tangent space. Then the limit of phi minus t, I put the star because it is the derivative of this map of W. T is zero as t goes to minus infinity. Okay. And what does it mean at the level of the universal cover? So at the level of the universal cover, it's a bit strange because 5T was not acting at all, apparently, on the fiber. So it's really the identity here. So the derivative is really the identity. And you don't see any contraction if you do not incorporate that the action of the group will bring back your vector and your element in a compact fundamental domain. And it is in this compact fundamental domain that you can look at the. So I have a nice drawing. I have a compact fundamental domain here. I have a tangent vector there. And it's a flow line. And I have phi t of v. Okay, so it means that if you take an element here and an element in the tangent space of the fiber, you see this belonging to the tangent space of the fiber at this place, and you bring it back to the compact set and bring this back to the compact set as to this new vector as to goes to zero. So I rewrite that in a formula. So what does it mean? That for every V as in the picture, and for every tangent vector at beta of phi plus infinity of V, sorry, of the space of isotropic line, and for every sequence Tn and going to minus infinity. So I also need the sequence gamma n that bring back phi Tn of V in this compact set. So for every sequence gamma n and such that say gamma n phi t n of v belongs to k, then gamma n of e or gamma n tangent action goes to zero. Sorry. Okay. So I have a point where every tangent vector at that point must be contracted by the sequence gamma n. So it means, and to show that, it is enough to show that, in fact, there is a basin of attraction for the sequence gamma n, and that this line belongs to this basin of attraction. So it is enough. So I'm trying to show this contraction, but it is enough to show that there exists an open set. I will not every of my open set U. So I maybe I will not call it curly U, but stretch U. So there is open set in F1. And it's an open neighborhood of the point here, such that the sequence gamma n in restriction to U converges to a constant. Okay. But what do you know about gamma? And you know that there is a vector here, so that gamma n inverse brings a vector here very close to this. Okay, so by hypothesis on the sequences, we have that the sequence gamma n inverse converges as n to the endpoint at minus infinity of V. So this is a point in the boundary of the group. Okay. And there is a little more on the construction of the boundary map, that if you if I write Kn, if I write the Cartan decomposition, gamma n, we know also that the image of this by the map beta has to be the limit of k prime n inverse applied to the Gauss vector. It's an analysis on the boundary maps I didn't do too much in this talk, and there is no inverse. We know that K n prime applied to the last vector converges. So this is a convergence in the space of isotropic line to the image of this one. So I didn't give any of them. And now I am almost done. The analysis we did yesterday say that every so you can assume also that gamma n converges as n to infinity to some point in the boundary. It can be a third point if there is no relation with, and it can be one of the 2 points. We don't have to, but I can assume further that the sequence converging also in the group, and what we know from the analysis of yesterday so I think I wanted to see this as an astral group with a representation, so there are rows missing, so this is a row of gamma n, and yes. And this is rho of gamma n. And I think this is correct. Okay. So you know that for every line D that is in F1, but that is transverse to the last line, not in the hyperplane divided by this line, then rho of gamma n of d converges as n goes to infinity to the line beta of eta. Good. So now this gives my open set, and the transversality of the map beta exactly means that the point I was interested in, beta of phi plus infinity of V, belongs to this complement. And so I have shown them. Okay. And you can see that the process can be reversed. Meaning that if you know that there are some contraction or some expansion of the flow on the image of a section, then the representation is another. So what is my proposition? I have a representation rho from gamma to OPQ. I assume that I have a sigma a section. No, I assume that I have a beta, but that I have a beta boundary map. So I can assume that I have a section as well, but I phrase it a little bit. So this one is continuous. It's equivariant and transverse. And you assume that phi d is expanding on vertical fibers at this. Okay. So to beta, there is a section associated, and this section defines a subset in F4. And along this subset, I have the contraction property that I've written. And in this situation, the conclusion, you can guess it, it's that gamma is another. So you do a little the same. You now start with the sequence gamma n, and it converts to some point at infinity. And this point at infinity, you put it as the endpoint of geodesic of starting from the vector v, and then you use the flow to. Okay. And this is the kind of tools that I will use to prove or to give a hint of the proof that anosov representation are stable under deformation. And what do I mean exactly? I will put a rather weak, in a sense, statement. But I mean, you can improve the proof and really show something on the space of all representation and not just a pass, as I stated the next result. So the theorem is the following. You have rho t. T belonging to 0, 1, a continuous path of homomorphism from gamma to OPQ. Okay, you assume that rho 0 is another. under this condition, there is a subinterval, small subinterval, where the representation stays another. So there exists a positive epsilon such that for every t in the interval 0 epsilon, rho t is an up. Okay. So out of the proof, there will be more. There will be the section sigma varies continuously as well. And from this, you will deduce that the equivalent maps varies continuously. Okay, so I need some setup to start the proof of this result. And the setup will be the following. I will work with bundles over un cross 0,1 instead of. Okay, so. But when I have a representation from gamma to the group of PQ that I would like to denote G, I have a G bundle associated with this, tied to it by curly P subscript rho, which is the quotient by gamma of un tilde cross G. Okay. And what is the action? It's the same as before. If I have a pair Vg, it's action by an element here. It's the natural action on the tangent bundle of n tilde gamma and the action given by white multiplication by G by rho gamma on the good. And this this fibers over the unit tangent model. Is it important that I define frat G bundle, principal G bundle, and frat G bundle? I plan to do this. So I saw some colleagues that say no, but. Okay, so maybe. Okay, maybe I still give the definition of G bundle. Because I would like to use a little this in some of the states. So meaning that there exists an open covering of G Mendel over some base M of M and for every, and I call the map P, for every U in U, I have a trivialization psi U on U, the trivial G Mendel, and for every U V in U, I have a map G U V from the intersection of these two sets to G, such that the change of trivialization are given by multiplication, F multiplication by G U V. Okay, so if I look at the composition of C, UV, and CU inverse. So this really is defined on this set. It is the biggest set where it can be defined. And to pair X, G is mapped to X, GUV of X times G. Okay. And I will call P flat G bundle if the GUV are locally constant. So what we really consider in our situation is really a bundle that I denote F subscript 0,1, which is the disjoint union for T belonging to 0,1 to of F subscript rho T. That you can see as the quotient of un tilde cross 0,1 cross f1 by the following action. An element gamma acts on the triple v t l by gamma of v, no action on t, and the action of l depends on t. So it's rho t of gamma pi to L. And I would like also to put all the principal bundle together. So the P subscript the interval 0,1 will be the disjoint union of P or subscript T for T belonging to 0,1. And those are bundles over the base, which is UN cross 0. So some contraction was happening in for T equals 0 in this bundle, and I want to show for small n of T there is still contraction here. So I will try to do that in the remaining time. And I will wanted to prove the following statement, but I will skip its proof. It's that as G bundle, so over UN cross 0,1 by P subscript 0,1 is isomorphic. To what? To P from of rho 0 cross the interval. So more precisely, there exists a map H of G bundle. So it commutes with the right action of G, such that there exists this isomorphism H, such that at time zero, restricted to P rho 0 is the identity of P rho 0. Okay, so what is such an isomorphism at the level of the cover? Okay, so I have a map from U and tilde cross the interval cross OPQ to U and tilde cross the interval cross OPQ. I decided to call it G, this is the group, so maybe I will skip. Keep this notation that to a triple VGT maps to the triple VT, some matrix of some element of G that I call HV of T of G. Yeah. And H of V zero is the identity element of G, and the equivariance of this map is easy to work out. It is that rho of gamma of H V T is rho zero, sorry, is equal to H gamma V T rho T of gamma. So for every gamma, for every T, and for every V, I have this relation. Good. So now I can use these maps to trivialize the bundle F. F0. So this gives a trivialization F01 by F0 cross the interval. So I want to call it K, this trivialization, and the restriction of K to F0 is the identity. Okay, and how do you define this map? You define it at the level of the universal cover. And what does it mean? You, in fact, you have to have a map from this kind of tuple with G replaced by F, but you will have an element L in the projective space here that will just multiply by the left by this H, and this will produce the map K. Okay. And, okay. So on this space, I have a vector field that I called Y that generates the flow, the flows put together phi t, and you will get here, another flow. I don't really need, in fact, this flow, but I will denote by psi t the flow when you conjugate by this. So one, now I am happy because I had a flow on different spaces and everything was varying. So now I have flows that varies with a parameter that we now call S, but are all on the same space. And I am more happy to deal with a situation that I have a varying flow on the same space that I have varying for and varying spaces. So this is why I perform. Okay, so I want to control in a more uniform way the contractions. And for this, we'll use a Riemann distance on the fibers of F4-0. So what you want to do is to choose continuously a Riemannian metric on the fibers of F subscript 0. So it gives distances d v for v in UN, and this v is a distance on the fiber by minus one of V. Okay. And yes, we have 3 minutes, so I think I can explain quite a bit. So what you will get from the contraction property of say phi minus t, you will get the following, that there exists a number r positive, a negative time t0, such that the r neighborhood of the image of sigma will be one fourth contracted by phi minus t0, such that yes, for every v in UN, for every z, z prime in the fiber over v, with the distance from z and from z prime to the image by the section sigma of V less than R, then the distance between the image by phi minus phi T zero of V between phi T zero of Z and phi T zero Z prime is less than 1/4 distance between Z and Z prime. Okay. So I will denote by N subscript R this R neighborhood. Of the section sigma, and I will denote by omega r the section, the space of sections of f rho zero contained, whose image is contained in an R. So the flow still acts on the space, and this action is also one force contracting. Okay, so you measure the distance between two sections as the supremum of the distance between this and this should do. Okay. So this is for phi T0, which is I have not really good notation of this, but this is psi t0 subscript 0. So it's above s equals 0, the action of psi t0. Okay? So now this maps, as s varies, varies continuously. So you reduce now by this kind of operator and this space omega r are varying continuously. So for small enough s, psi t0 of s will be contracting on this space. So we do not, you will find a unique fixed point here. But by uniqueness of this fixed point, you will have that this fixed point must be invariant by the flow, and it has some contraction property. And out of this, you can work out that the section that you will find for small deformation comes from an equivalent map, and that you, the contraction that you have here will give the contraction needed for the equilibrium. Okay, thank you for your patience. I finished.
Okay, so let's thank Olivier for his series of lecture. Thanks again.